Moving on to our next session, I would now like to invite Honorable Mr. Justice K.S. Radhakrishna Panikkar, former Judge Supreme Court of India, for a keynote address on justice in 2020 and beyond. Over to you, sir.
See, basically, I would like to, I must first of all, consider it as a great honor and privilege to be part of this ADR Virtual Conclave 2020, organized by the ET World. And of course, to speak on a subject of national and international importance. We have eminent panel of experts, including Justice Deepak Mishra, former Chief Justice of India. I must congratulate all the panelists, and I'm sure it will be a great educational process for all of us. But basically, I would discuss about five topics. First, Indian judiciary and virtual courts, challenges and solutions. The second topic I would like to talk is ADR, its flexibility and adaptability, with emphasis on ad hoc, institutional arbitration, domestic as well as international. The third subject I would like to speak is on international arbitration centers and virtual courts, the new strategies and best practices. Of course, force majeure, I think that will be a live discussion. Everybody will participate in. I will just contribute not much, but I will also speak on that. So first, I would like to talk on the first subject, that Indian judiciary and virtual courts. What are the challenges? Everybody knows that India, compared to any other countries, India has got the largest number of courts and cases. We have about 25 high courts in the country, about 672 district courts, and more than 15,000 subordinate courts, and a large number of tribunals, including MACT, NCLAT, TDSAT, and so many tribunals. So put together, we have a vast number of courts, tribunals, and other forums for dispute resolution. In the Supreme Court itself, there are about more than 75,000 cases now. The High Court is more than 16 lakhs cases, and we have about 3.5 crores cases in the subordinate courts. Now, of course, everybody knows that the Supreme Court, as early as 2005, Supreme Court and the Government of India conceived the e-court project based on the action plan for implementation of information and communication technology. In 2014, Government of India approved the computerization of about 14,249 district and subordinate courts in the country. And all the courts were connected to the national judicial data grid by case and court management system. And basically, this, after the introduction of that, the main benefit that the litigant public got is to provide e-filing, e-payment. In other words, it was only basically a citizen-centric services. We may get video court conference facilities, court management, and so on. If we compare it to the present situation, I would say it's a really rudimentary stage, in the matter that everything is computerized. Of course, we have an e-court. E-court is a completely computerized court. Unlike a computerized court, it's everything digital. But the main problem that we face compared to other systems is that we have in the Constitution of India, Article 145.4 of the Constitution of India speak of all the judgment the Supreme Court be pronounced in open court. That is the first time we find the word open court in our constitution. But the legislature was, the constitution makers was very guarded, saying that they only said that all the judgment in the Supreme Court be delivered in open court. But it is not the High Court, not any other courts, but only a delivery of judgment. With regard to other procedure, the constitution is silent. Even though the open, then in other words, constitution speak of only the open court only in one provision, Article 145.4. But at the same time, we have the Civil Procedure Code and Criminal Procedure Code. In the Criminal Procedure Code, there's a section 327.1, which also speaks of open court, to which public have access, with the exception of magistrate can, exceptional circumstances can hold in-camera proceedings. There's another provision in the CRPC, Section 327.2, that also speaks of in-camera proceedings in cases relating to the Section 376, 376A, and so on. Then the CPC also, we have certain provisions. We say section 153B of the CPC speaks of open court, to which public have access, with of course some exceptions and provisos. And we have Order 8 Rule 14, the CPC, which say that evidence has to be taken in open court. And then we have Order 32A and Rule 2 CPC, which also enables the court to conduct in-camera proceedings. If you look at then where are the other provisions, section 22 of the Hindu Marriage Act, section 43 of the Parsi Marriage Act, section 33 of the Special Marriages Act, and so on. So if we look at the constitutional scheme, and you also look at the Criminal Procedure Code, provisions of the Criminal Procedure Code, as well as Civil Procedure Code, we will be led to believe that by and large, we thought of only open court, not virtual courts. But at the same time, we'll also find some decisions of the Supreme Court also. The Supreme Court, interpreting Article 21 of the Constitution, also said, lay down the principle of fair trial, which includes open court proceedings. And we have Nijesh Mirajkar case, and we have the Tripathi's case, and so on. But I would like to impress upon these gathering participants is that recently, of course, Chandrachud, as the judge of the Supreme Court, has also said that the virtual courts is not a substitute for open court. I agree with him with a rider. But left to myself, I will say a large number of cases in the Supreme Court, as well as in the High Court and various other forums, could be disposed of by applying the virtual court proceedings. Because we have a large number of writ petitions where decisions are made only on the basis of documents, where no oral evidence is there, no evidence of witnesses are there. So those type of cases can be disposed by virtual courts. There need not be an open hearing. There are exceptions. I'm not saying all the type of cases. But I would advocate, let the Chief Justice of India hold a conference of all the Chief Justices of the High Courts, including the representative of the Bar Council of India and other bar associations. And following a proper case management, court management, we can segregate certain type of cases which could be disposed of on the basis of following the virtual court proceedings, not open court, because that is the need of the hour. If everything was okay, we are not faced with a present pandemic, of course, we could have continued with the open court proceedings. But we are faced with a situation where the entire judicial system, and I mean the judicial system includes everything, even the tribunals and all of the decision-making forums, has come to a grinding halt. We have to find out a solution. So it's left to myself that certain cases still can be disposed of using virtual court proceedings. There is one point I would like to emphasize. Now, the second point I would like to say that as far as ADR is concerned, it sounds a different, actually a different situation, different platform. Because that's why when we introduced Section 689, the CPC, way back in 1999, the legislator thought of having an alternative dispute resolution forums like ADR, where we have not only that, we have legislated Log Adalat, Legal Service Authorities Act, to dispose of matters to Log Adalat. We have also thought of, by introducing Section 89, that the court shall refer most of the cases to arbitration, negotiation, or other forums, mediation, and so on. So this was what was intended by us early as 99. So that is one of the basic reasons why people preferred ADR, with the result that we can save time, we can save cost. But if you look at the provisions of the 1996 Act and following the various amendments, one, we can visualize that parties' autonomy is the main thing. In India, what we see, we have large number of ad hoc arbitration compared to any other countries. Large number of ad hoc arbitration via institutional arbitrations. So for ad hoc arbitrations are concerned, my experience as well as and from others, that even for the first day of sitting till the conclusion, everything's done in in-person proceedings. There is no video conferencing facilities being used. Rarely we use telecommunication facilities. Even for the first sitting, for laying down the procedural rules or procedure to be followed for conducting the arbitration, we hold in open court proceedings, face-to-face proceedings. I don't know, there's no necessity at all. In all this, till I must say, till they, if there are evidence, if there are oral evidence from either side, till the fact witnesses are examined, all these proceedings can go on either by video conferencing or even by what you call virtual court proceedings. The question arises, the difficulty arises when we have to examine fact witnesses. That also I got a suggestion. After all, from my experience, I say, what is a fact witness? Fact witness basically retrace what the claimant has said. If the claimant is examining any fact witness, he will retrace what he has already said in the statement or claim. Just like the defense witness is a fact witness for the defense side, they will say what is statement of defense. So there's nothing new. And after all, you must remember, is a commercial dispute, and fact witness can only retread what the facts are on the basis of documents before the tribunal. Another thing also I would like to impress upon that. Now, the fact witness can never interpret any contract. He can only express his view. Interpretation of the contract is the job of the tribunal after hearing both the counsel. So in commercial matters, except in very rare matters where expert witnesses have to be examined, probably we may require a little more caution. So this is one of the aspects I would like to highlight. Now, we have a lot of institutional arbitrations also. Now, another thing I would like to say, in ad hoc arbitrations, whenever we lay down a procedure, is only for that particular case, unlike institutional arbitrations. Institutional arbitration can lay down their own rules. And once parties agree to follow that rules, they are bound to follow that, because there will be uniformity in all institutional arbitration matters. So parties will have to follow that. Now, suppose a particular institutional arbitration includes a provision for disposing your cases by following the virtual court proceedings, then if parties accept that, necessarily they have to follow that procedure. It's part of the provision, and they're bound to follow that. Now, the main challenges I find and main points that always been canvassed against the virtual court proceedings, one is that the authenticity and credibility of the witnesses cannot be properly assessed by the tribunal. After all, what is authenticity? It is a testimony of the witness. The authenticity can always be judged by the tribunal, even if the witness is examined through a video conference. There's no difficulty also. But some people, they say, if you look at section 155 of the Indian Evidence Act, we say that the credit of the witness can be impeached on certain grounds, including demeanor of the witness. I have a caveat for that. See, this is not a criminal case. If it's a criminal case, we can understand the demeanor of witness has something to say. In a commercial dispute, I do not know what is the demeanor of a witness. So there is no basis in the argument that section 155 would be violated if the witness is examined through video conference or virtual court. Another argument that is raised is on the basis of section 136 of the Indian Evidence Act with regard to the admissibility of evidence. And admissibility of evidence is purely the job of the judge or the tribunal. And witness only renders the evidence, whether it is admitted and which provision is it not be admitted is a matter for the tribunal to decide. Another argument that is raised on the basis of section 140 of the Evidence Act, where they say the character of the witness can be questioned in cross-examination. I don't know what is preventing the cross-examiner in questioning the character of the witness through a video conferencing or a virtual course. I think these arguments, so far as the ADR is concerned, is out of place. If you strictly follow the criminal law or a criminal case, of course, all these provisions, section 155, 136 or 140 may be of some relevance. We are not speaking of a criminal case at all. We are now talking about alternative dispute resolution mechanism where we have to save time as well as cost. Another argument that has been raised against the virtual courts as well as the examination of witnesses is that the security and credibility of the witness or confidentiality of the documents are not properly assessed or properly looked into if you follow by the virtual court proceedings. That also is not correct. And we have a lot of protocols, national, where how the document has to be kept, what is called the data security, and all these are covered by various international conventions. If you got time, I will speak on that also. Another thing lawyers usually raise against these that it may disrupt a proper teamwork by the lawyers and the clients. I don't know how it affects the teamwork. Lawyers can always can their own facilities. They can also discuss with the client before and before arguing the case or before the present filing of the pleadings and so on. So teamwork is not disrupted by virtual court proceedings. Teamwork is not respected by not disrupted by video conferencing at all. Then, of course, other technical issues are also being raised about lack of connectivity, then time zone difference, then language problem, then speed band, and so on, cybersecurity. These aspects has all been covered by the technology. One advantage of the court as well as ADR is that, see, we have a foolproof technological system is there. How to work? How to work and how to modulate that system? That is the question. So, and suppose we are in 20 years, before 20 years, we don't have any of the system. At the moment, we have all these systems in place. And if you look at the international scenario also, we find it's ANSITRAL also in Article 17, as early as 2010, has said that the arbitral tribunal in exercising its discretion, the words are very important, yes, discretion, shall conduct proceedings as to avoid unnecessary delay and expenses and to provide a fair and efficient process for resolving parties' disputes. So this was envisaged even by Article 17 of the UNCITRAL rules. And the ICC, International Commercial Arbitration, ICC also, as early as 2000, has got a platform which is called Net Case Platform. The Net Case Platform is an online environment where parties have to execute a statement of acceptance. Once you execute the statement of acceptance and you enter a Net Case Platform, then you enter with a passport, then where everything is provided, including video conference as early as 2000. And we have a lot of other protocols. In 2004 and 2017, we have the use of information technology, international arbitration, which contains very useful tools for exchange of electronic documents. And data integrity and data security has also been taken care of. Data integrity is the assurance of accuracy and consistency of data over the entire life cycle. And data integrity is different from data security. Data security is protecting the digital data. For also there are proper protocol in place. Only thing, we must use these protocols to our arbitration matters, the domestic institutional as well as international arbitrations. And witness can also be examined by video link. That is also provided, a proper protocol also being provided for that. And I'm not taking all those protocols because they are already in place. But one more thing I would like to impress upon is that there's a guidance note issued by the ICC in this year, 2020, where they have laid down on possible measures to be taken during the time of COVID. If you look at, there's a checklist in that guidance note also. Every aspect is in detail dealt with in the checklist. Only after satisfying all what has been stated in checklist, then only you can start the proceedings. In fact, the question how the transcript service has to be provided, who are the interpreters to be provided, what is the technical support to be provided, what is the online etiquette, what is the due process to be followed, and so on. But there are some international protocols where they say that the rules also provide that the institute can go for virtual court hearing. In a case where a party is object, because one party may object to go to refer the matter to virtual court proceedings. In a case when party object, the matter being referred to a virtual court, the question is whether the arbitration can go on. Protocol takes care of that also. Still the arbitration can go on. Because even if one of the parties object that we are not willing to go for a virtual hearing or virtual court, but only thing they must be guarded, the tribunal should be guarded, that they should follow the due process. Due process means they must, everybody should be treated equal in all check, all in all aspects. So at the very beginning, from starting of the arbitration till conclusion, whether due process has been followed or not. Once the tribunal can satisfy themselves that they have followed the due process, the challenging that award in the court is absolutely remote. It's very difficult to, you suppose, you properly follow the due process. I don't think that any court will interfere with an award on mere ground that there's a violation of natural justice. So that is also one of the aspects to be borne in mind. Another thing also important aspect also that has been taken by the Hague Evidence Convention. It's called Evidence Convention of Hague. In fact, Hague Convention was passed on 18th 1970 on taking of evidence of witnesses as early as 70, followed by the 2019 Hague Convention for virtual hearing through the evidence. So how the evidence has to be taken, in what manner the room has to be kept, and how to avoid tutoring of the witness, and how the credibility and security of the witness is maintained, all these are taken care of. All these are in the protocol made by the Hague Evidence Protocol. So if you follow all these protocols, I'm absolutely sure there may be no difficulty in examining a witness, especially in ADR. I'm stressing that ADR. I'm not talking about the criminal case. I'm not talking that all the civil cases. I'm not talking that all other type of cases can be decided by virtual courts. But as far as the arbitration ADR concerned, I would say that this is the rule. Virtual court proceeding is the rule, the other is the exception. If you look at the judiciary, high courts, Supreme Court, and criminal courts are concerned, I would say that the open court proceeding is the rule, other is the exception. But exceptions, you cannot say exceptions, even exceptions you can be in this era, even the exception can later become a rule, because there is no other way, because in the present scenario, there is a saying that innovation is the best solution for uncertainty. We are in a stage of uncertainty. So innovation is the best solution. But we are a little more in a better place, because there's nothing to innovate. We have all the technology. Technology is in place. Only thing, we must utilize this technology properly, follow all the protocols, so there's no difficulty. Another thing also I would advocate, especially in the ADR, see, there are a lot of cases, in my experience, there are a lot of cases that can be decided only on the basis of documents. It's called documents only or records only. If cases can be decided only on the basis of documents and records, then there is no question of examining a witnesses. So that argument can be heard in virtual court proceedings. Arguments can be heard in video conferencing. So large number of such cases can be disposed of. Difficulty arises only when witness has to be examined. Now, I would say I already indicated also, but their security, their confidentiality, everything can be met by the protocols which are already in place. So I will say that in the present scenario, I repeat once again, so for a judicial, the criminal courts and other type of matters pending for the courts, as court stricto sensu, maybe the open court proceedings may be the rule. Other is the in camera and other proceedings an exception. But ADR is concerned, left to myself, I will advocate that virtual court proceedings is the rule and other is exception. Because we are faced with an unprecedented situation. We have to overcome the situation. We have the technology. Fortunately, I said already indicated that we have the technology in place. Then why not to use the technology? Protocols are in place. Why not to use this technology? Otherwise, everybody will stand. The entire system will stand still. Even now, so many arbitrations are being adjourned because there is no because nobody is now, either parties are not agreeing for a virtual hearing. Of course, last week we had one Section 17 application to video conferencing. It was very effective. Here an order is reserved. There are no difficulty at all. So I think I must utilize ADR. All those who are practicing in ADR should use this system, so that things will move on and we can get over the present pandemic situation. So and a lot of other things to say. I think I have already exceeded my time. So I'm thankful to the organizations. I'm thankful to the ET World Economic Times for giving this opportunity to express my views. And I will once again request the Chief Justice of India and all the judges, including the Bar Council of India, and as well as the Bar Association to hold a conference and to a proper case and court management. Several cases can be segregated, and those cases can be disposed of by virtual court proceedings. So thank you so much for giving this opportunity. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. I'm sure our viewers have a lot to take away from this.